Metal Max is a series literally as old as I am, and despite that, I had never heard of it. That's probably due to the fact that, with the exception of a single North American release, this series has never ventured outside Japan. I went in totally blind, having only seen a short trailer. I knew it had tanks, I knew it was an RPG, but was it any good? Well, yes. It's pretty fun and it's pretty good. It is distinctly low budget, but not in a strictly bad way. It feels like a game made by a team of really great developers, but they just weren't given enough of a budget to make it as good as it could have been. There were clear sacrifices made, and unfortunately for those of you looking for a complex story with great writing, I'd guess that the majority of the sacrifices were in that department. I wouldn't say the game is totally lacking in story, or even that the story is bad. I'd say it has just enough to give you some idea of progression and to guide you through the game, but neither the story nor the characters are particularly interesting, and I would again put that down to the average writing. The concept has promised, the characters themselves have potential. They aren't bad, it's just painfully middle of the road for the most part. It's set in a post-apocalyptic Japan, where there is little left other than a vast desert. Monsters and mechs destroyed most of humanity some time ago, and have just recently heightened their efforts to wipe out the remaining survivors. Luckily for the main character, he happens upon one of the most effective countermeasures humans have against these threats, a tank. That tank soon becomes a fleet of tanks as you travel around in search of survivors and ways to put an end to this war. See, the premise is fine, the story is mostly fine as well. It does attempt to address some things that would come up in a post-apocalyptic world, like, do the few remaining female survivors get to choose who they want to repopulate the Earth with? But these mostly come off as creepy subplots because the story takes a backseat to gameplay. We just don't see a whole lot of it. It's kind of like watching episodes of a TV show at random instead of chronologically. Stuff just happens with very little lead-in or context. Luckily for Metal Max Xeno, it doesn't need to rely on an epic story to keep you invested. The gameplay on its own is quite addictive. I actually started writing this script as a first impressions video after playing for roughly 6 hours. I then went to gather a little bit more footage and ended up playing for 8 hours straight. So I started editing the script and before you know it, I had put another 20 hours in. Now that I think about it, it isn't quite addictive, it's really addictive. Collecting and customizing tanks is a full game on its own. There's a lot you can do with each given tank. You can change everything from the weapons to the engine and even the chassis. There are multiple different weapon types that each contain a huge variety of weapons. You might think that a cannon is just a cannon, but in addition to the caliber of the cannon that you might expect to vary in the real world, cannons in Metal Max Xeno can have different elemental effects. They might attack a single target or multiple targets. They might even attack 3 times instead of 1. And you have to manage your weapon installations against your tank's weight limit and power capacity. You've also got control over visual aspects of your tanks. You can customize the color of the tank along with each of the weapons, and you can give each tank a name, though this is restricted to just 7 characters, likely due to no change being made to the character limit between the English release and the original Japanese one. It would take me a lifetime to go over all the aspects of tank customization, so suffice it to say, it's rather deep and very addictive. Well, addictive in conjunction with the rest of the gameplay, which can kind of be viewed as the hunt for more tanks and more parts. You will be following a loose story thread for the most part, but I often found that the desire to upgrade my tank was more important than anything else going on in the game. The tank controls well, the UI is slick and easy to understand, and the controls feel natural and work great. The technical aspects are all really solid, and that helps the deceptively simple gameplay from feeling like a chore. The turn-based combat is also one of the fastest-paced systems of its type that I've ever experienced. Normally, when you think turn-based, you think laid-back and sometimes relatively slow, and despite my love for laid-back combat, Metal Max Xeno always felt quick, punchy, and overall enjoyable. While exploring the world in your tank, you will come across an enemy or a group of enemies, and you'll have the opportunity to kill them before even entering battle, assuming you have a strong enough weapon, of course. If you fail to kill them in the one preemptive shot you're given, you'll be sent to the battle screen, where it's a fairly standard turn-based affair. But the turns play out very quickly, and there is no waiting for an ATB bar to fill up or anything like that. It's just select what you want your three characters to do this turn, turn plays out, select your abilities again, rinse and repeat. There is a hard mode option that adds a ton of health to enemies, which makes battles last quite a bit longer, but that is only available in New Game Plus, so you'll have to beat the game on the standard difficulty first. You also get to explore dungeons on foot as well, but battles become random encounters and it's kind of dull overall. Combat is basically the same, you just have less weapons to choose from and you aren't inside one of your glorious tanks. Characters do have different classes, which affects what they are good at to some degree, but it mostly affects the way their stats grow. Soldiers and medics might be useful on foot, but hunters are the go-to for tank combat. Dungeons are all a bit the same. I'd wager the other main compromise in terms of budget was the environment design. Environments do look like something from the PS2, possibly PS3 era, but that certainly isn't because the developers weren't talented enough. I know this because in stark contrast with the environments, the characters, enemies, tanks, and art are all really well designed. They wouldn't look out of place in a modern big budget JRPG. There is incredible variety in the enemies too. There are almost no palette swaps, especially compared to most games today, which repeat half a dozen enemy models ad nauseam in a different shade of green. The animations aren't exactly top shelf either, but this was also a PlayStation Vita release in Japan. We just didn't get that version over here. It's clear that the Vita was always in mind during development, and in that respect, the animations and even the environments don't look out of place next to most Vita games. Metal Max Xeno is a really solid game. It's incredibly addictive despite the obvious compromises that were made due to budget and platform restrictions. Thankfully, these compromises are reflected in the lower than standard shelf price of the game. There are far worse ways to spend 40 bucks. Just keep in mind that this game is very much gameplay focused. If you're strictly a story gamer, you'll probably want to look elsewhere. But having said that, I'm someone who predominantly plays games for the stories, and I found myself addicted to this little diamond in the rough. Thanks for liking, subscribing, and sharing, and I'll see you all soon.